your gut reaction is the moment something is found, that's when it's discovered. And a lot of the material we collect, we have a field identification for it, but often it's only after a long time in the lab being prepared and stabilized that you recognize that it's something else. That's often more exciting than the moment you pull it out of the ground or excavate it for the first time, because that's when it gets a face and a name and an identity, and you start to understand how it's going to fit into the big picture of what we're doing. We put a lot of work into the Morrison early in our history. We've decided to go back and start over with all the new tools and questions that we have now.
You can see the bus bar. That's the central.
The Morrison Formation is in the late Jurassic, so everything we find there is around that time interval. We're short on information about some of the smallest animals in the ecosystem, like the small mammals and reptiles and amphibians, that actually probably made up most of the species. We're particularly excited about our excavation because we're finding some of the smaller dinosaurs that people historically really didn't find and have been very rare. So CT scanning's been really helpful for Morrison Formation fossils. The matrix can be quite dry and crumbly. As it dries out through the preparation process, it gets increasingly difficult to study the fossil. And also that drying process, because the matrix is full of clay and can shrink, that tends to split apart parts of the fossil. Right now, I'm CT scanning just one of the field jackets from the field. And we know that it contains a vertebra, but we don't know what it belongs to. And I'm scanning it essentially to make a record of what it was like in the ground, and also to know if there was anything around the vertebra that we didn't see in the field. So actually, when we do CT scans of our field jackets before they're prepared, and we see the fossil in a more pristine state than actually we're able to get it out of the jacket in the end.
This is some of the material that was recently prepared from our latest excavation, and this all came from one jacket. It's more of the smaller animals, which are rarer because they're small and rarer because traditionally it wasn't what was being focused on. These are two tail bones of a small meat-eating dinosaur. This is the humerus, or the upper arm bone, of an ornithopod. This bone hasn't even been identified yet. We not only don't know what kind of animal it comes from, we're not even sure what bone it is yet.
The excavation site that this field jacket is from is very exciting to us because it has the bones of a small-bodied theropod dinosaur. Those are the predatory dinosaurs. But it also preserves the bones of a small-bodied ornithopod dinosaur. And those animals are bipedal herbivorous dinosaurs. So this vertebra belongs to one of at least two new species that we've been excavating.
We also have some plant specimens, and because most of us work on bones and animals, we don't recognize the importance of the plants that we're seeing. We had a paleobotanist come by and get very excited by some of the stuff we found, and I'm pretty sure at least one of them has already turned into a new species.
In addition to that, in the project team, there are geologists who are interested in how environments on Earth were changing around that time and what impacts that had on evolving animals. So we don't know what we're going to find when we start excavating a site. We just have a few bones generally that have weathered out on the surface through the process of erosion. And it may be that site preserves like a mixture of different dinosaurs that's quite different to what we expected because we can't see into the ground. So even when we're excavating, we're more or less only guessing which dinosaurs we're finding. Really, the actual discovery and confirmation of what we found goes on in the lab.